Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I will introduce you the library Namba and the just-in-time compiler of Python and how to use it to speed up your Python code, the execution of your Python code. I prepare a notebook as usual that later on I will upload to the repository. And I will give you an example, and we will go through the main features of the Namba, how they do it, and show you the pros and cons, and when you can use it, or at least give you some insight when you can use. As I said in previous videos, you need to try. All these libraries are fantastic, but they apply in specific scenarios. And then, you just need to know that you have it there. In case that you need to optimize the code, you just need to try. I always tell this: do experimentation when you face that issue. Experiment, try the different options you have, and you will see later that in some cases it's just refactor the code that you are producing rather than use one of these wonderful libraries that they work very good, but not in all scenarios. Let's see it later on the examples in the notebook, and you will understand why. So Namba, what is Namba? It's a library, just-in-time compiler, which essentially what it's doing is it's compiling the Python code, which is an interpreted code. It's not compiled like C or C++ or C#. It's interpreted. This means that once you run the Python script, this script needs to be transformed into something that the CPU understand. The CPU doesn't understand Python. The CPU understand instruction, native instructions for the CPU, and this is what they had to be done at execution time with the Python code. Exactly the same happens with Java or with other interpreted language. So this is like high level languages that is very easy for the human to understand. But for the machine, the machine only understands zeros and one and native instructions. The CPU doesn't understand Python or Java or C. It has to be transformed to something that the CPU is able to read and to execute. And then this is exactly what the Namba decorators in this case, because it's only it had two decorators for that purpose, git and ngit, and what we are doing here is just decorating some functions in our Python code, and these functions are compiled into something that the machine understand. Okay? And this is done, and every time that you use the function, is using this compiled code rather than to transform again the Python code into something that the machine understands. So we have two decorators, git and ngit. They are exactly the same. The only one that ngit require a strictly tight control, and in GIT it's just compiling and doesn't demand this control of the types in input and output. So if you decide to use NGIT, you have to be sure you have to be sure of the data types that they are using for input and output. Once you are sure, this means that if you are using if you say that the data in input n is a integer 32, it has to be an integer 32, and if you send something that is different there, it's not going to perform well. No, it will try first of all with the integer 32. When it's not happening, the compilation fails, it will try to do a compilation then with GIT and not with NGIT. So you will be losing time at that moment. So what happened here is you design the function, you need to be sure that always you are going to receive an input of integer 32 or integer 32 for the parameter A. For the parameter B is another integer 32, and the output is going to be a float 64, for example. But you need to ensure that this is going to happen in all the scenarios. It's not what happened is you compile the function with NGIT, and once it's compiled, if you send some other data types, the compilation fails, and then on it will try to do this compilation again in GIT, where there is not that data type control, and then on you are losing time with this, first of all, sending the execution to the NGIT compiled version, and when it fails, the number library will compile it with GIT version, and it will execute it. And then this is a penalty on the execution rather than an improvement. So there is also some parameters that you need to understand. You can take a look to the documentation. It's quite well explained with examples. We will use some of them here. No Python mode, it's just compiling and not using the Python C API. It's just compiling directly into the code that the CPU understand, and there are the two interesting options as well, cache and parallel cache. Is something similar to the concept that we saw in FunTools, and parallel is parallel execution, which also you need to know how this is applied, because it's the function that you try to compile is not suitable for parallelization, it will fail. And then you try to compile with parallelization, it will fail, and then on number will try to compile again without parallelization. You will see this now on the example. We are gonna use the same examples we used in the previous video from Vectorize, and where we create a pandas data frame with 1 million rows. Every value is an integer from 1 to 200. And we had just two columns with 1 million rows. So we create, this is one very simple example from the documentation. You will see this is just sum up two values, and then we apply to the two columns we have here in our data frames. We test different flavors of our decorator. We use NGIT. Why? Because we are sure that we had the same input and the output is going to be the same here. So we are applying here this function to a very lab example, no laboratory example. We are not having this in the Python code. In the Python code, in a production application, you have many scenarios that you need to evaluate before to decide if you apply NGIT or GIT. Yes, I give you this is a very controlled scenario where you have the input. The inputs always, because you define it like this, are integers, so we can apply safely NGIT in this case. And then we apply the pure NGIT here. NGIT by default is no Python true, no Python mode, which means that we will not use the Python C API. We will use directly the compile code. So we are going to compile this function. Here we use parallelization. Here parallelization apply because we have two columns. Can use parallelization, cache mode, and cache mode together with parallelization. We see here we apply. We use the method apply of the pandas data frame. We apply to the row. We had to do it that way, as you know, because this is more than one column. We cannot apply the function directly to the pandas series. There is more than one series. We need to apply LambdaRho. LambdaRho, you probably know that is very inefficient because we read the whole rho. In this case, it's not going to have an impact just because we have two rows in the data frame. But imagine that instead to have two rows, you had 1 million of rows. And then this means that every time that you apply the function to the row, you read a row with 1 million of positions, of columns, and then you choose only the A and B. And this is fully, completely inefficient. In this case, this is not going to be a penalty. We will just observe the speed of applying using the native method implemented in pandas, no? And you see here we get 18.2 seconds after applying in average, seven times it was tested with time it. And then we have here the different flavors. Here is time it 3.27, parallelization 1.37, cache 3.3, is slightly worse, probably because there is no point to cache here. We are not reusing any data, so no point to use the cache. It's only implementing, increasing the execution time. And quick cache and parallel, we don't have any improvement. So again, cache here in this scenario is not helping. And then on in this scenario, you see there is an improvement, huge improvement. This is something incredible. But yes, again, consider that this is a lab scenario. Case that you had to improve the speed of a function, you need to test it and see if it which improvement you get. I test here the function with vectorize, the vectorization, and you see here we also improve the speed in comparison with the method apply. But well, it's a little bit more modest, no? It's almost 45 times faster, but obviously, in this case, in comparison with 5,565 times, well, it's no point to discuss which one is faster, no? But now I will give you an example. This is the same that I used on the vectorize in the previous video. We use vectorize and we saw we see that in this function vectorize is not working. And also we use a function that in purpose was really bad design, because using if here is very inefficient, absolutely inefficient, I know. Even if you evaluate the data you have and how the ifs are designed, you can say A, so this you have here 100,000 rows in this data frame, and let's suppose that we had 250,000 Adam, 250,000 Chan, 250,000 Eliza, and 250,000 Odon. So if we look at the code, so Adam is fine, Chan is going to evaluate all of them, all if and elif, up to you get the final return, where you return the name. Absolutely inefficient. This is no point. So we have here Elisa is fine second time. Well, it's randomly. Sometimes will be better. Well, at the end you had in the end you had to choose one. That is the initial one, no? So well, there is this is no point. It's correctly designed. And the final Odon is in the fourth position. And then if you check here, start with I. So I is not included in our choice. So this we are going to be evaluating this for a chunk anodon whenever it's gonna happen. So this is completely inefficient. So here I just make a permutation of the position of O and I, and to create a improved version of this parse name. No, this is just, I want to show you that sometimes it's better to redesign the function to something better or something more realistic according to the data that you expect to receive. And here I do a third version, which I finally also improved the maximum, in my opinion, that we can improve this function. And this is the case that instead to complete the whole evaluation of the ifs which for the name Chan, I put it at the beginning, and then at the four first positions of my conditional are the letters that are included in my data, because it's this way we avoid to any of my choices here going through the whole evaluation of the conditional tree. That was the case on that happens with Chan name on the original function. And after that, I use as well the JIT in this case with no Python equal true and with different flavors, parallel and cache. And here we have the execution. So the first function, the original one, is taking 159 milliseconds. The second version, where I do the permutation of the I and O, is taking 149. Just simply doing this permutation is 10 milliseconds faster. And the last one is the one where I correctly implement just with the if. I know that the if is not the option for this, but just check that doing refactoring the code, we are improving the speed. And then I'll check what happened with the JIT in this case. 747 milliseconds, the parallel didn't work. Obviously, there is nothing to parallelize here. And the cache as well improved a little bit, but in comparison with our 141 milliseconds, is nothing. Why this is happening? It's exactly the same that we explained with vectorize or with LRU. In these complex functions, the compiler is going to take a lot of time to create a compiled function in native code, which translate this complex function, which at the same time as well is very inefficient. This inefficiency is also translated to inefficiency even in machine code, in compiled code. And also it takes a lot of time. So the improvement that you have run in native code is lost when you have to create a very complex compiled code. No? And then you don't get any advantage to use it even with EIT, no? Even with compile code. And then what I want to say with this, again, you need to try. You need to, you know, now vectorize, you know, FunTools, Namba. There is multiple tools, but sometimes it's just look at the code, refactor it. Here probably the best case is use a case, which you are going to improve a lot with a selector rather than to using a conditional with some mapping maybe, but yeah, probably the selector is the best. It's the best case because you don't evaluate all these functions here. You have to, let's imagine here for chunk, you hold to the first conditional, you make the name to lower the null, you check if it starts with A, no, you move to the second line, again to lower, start with no, move to the third, and so on and so forth, until you get the fit conditional that your name is not matching, and finally you return the name. So here I show you how just refactoring is improving the speed, and even using a library, we use it in this video as well with vectorization. It didn't work as well. You see here the original function with 259 and with vectorize 186. So just many times is just refactor the function, use it correctly the language, rather than how to say use one of the libraries. You can do both. You can just simply refactor, again in this case probably a selector is going to run, and I'm completely sure that the selector is going to run faster, and then on use GIT or other tool just to improve it even more, no? But the redesign of the function in some case is mandatory before to use it with one of these other libraries which help us to improve the speed of the code. And as I say, always test it. If you don't test it, you need to test to understand which one, and with experience, with times, you will later on understand which one apply better to the function, to the scenario that you are working on. We will look at other libraries, especially those that are working with pandas. This is here another example of inefficiencies. There is better tools like pandas in the market, I will say, far away better. But well, pandas is very popular, many people know it, and well, there is also around pandas and other tools to help to improve transformations in pandas, to parallelize the processing, to like DAX or pandas parallel, and then you can improve a lot as well the transformations of pandas. I know pandas very well as well, and then I use it very very often, and yeah, but I know that there is other tables or other technologies that perform faster, but well, yeah, many cases you will find that when you work in a group, in a team, but yeah, it's Pandas, NumPy, some of these libraries are very popular, most of the people knows how to work, and then in reuse or read the code or somebody is easy when the tools and the libraries that they are using is the same that you know or that you are fluent with. Then it's easy to share the code and to improve it and to refactor it and to continue with the job that somebody did, no? Okay, that's all. I will be uploading the new videos about this topic in the following days, and I will upload this also to the repository after finishing the video. And that's all. I hope that you enjoy it and you like it and you find it interesting and useful for your job or for your training or for whatever you are watching this video. And thank you very much for watching. Give me a like if you enjoy with the video. Subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. And share with your friends and colleagues just to promote a little bit the channel. Thank you very much. See you soon.